Incoming Government Senate Leader, Senator Eric Abetz, thank you very much for your time. I want to start, first of all, with the result on Saturday night. There was a big swing against the Labor government. Do you put it in part down to the reaction to the Greens-Labor alliance at the state level in Tasmania?
The election result in Tasmania was a substantial result in anybody's language. And when you analyse why the swing in Tasmania was so much larger than elsewhere in the country, and especially the swing against the Greens, which saw their vote cut in half, you've got to ask the question, what is the reason? And there is no doubt that the Green-Labor experiment in Canberra and Hobart saw Tasmania suffering from a double whammy, and the people of Tasmania gave expression to their feelings on Saturday, and that expression was exceptionally clear.
On to your incoming government and your job as the government Senate leader, how soon will the coalition government seek to have the carbon tax legislation through the parliament, through the upper house?
The coalition said during the election campaign that item number one was the repeal of the carbon tax, and that will be introduced as soon as it can in the House of Representatives, and once it's passed through there, it will undoubtedly come up to the Senate. But from the coalition point of view, there's a clear mandate. The people of Australia have spoken. They do want an end to the carbon tax, and we as the incoming government will seek to facilitate the wishes of the Australian people as expressed in the ballot box on Saturday.
But do you accept that it's likely to be a fruitless exercise at least until July 1 next year, because the current Senate is likely not to vote for it?
That will depend largely on what the Greens do and what the Australian Labor Party do. We would invite them to reconsider their attitude, the belligerent attitude, especially of the Greens, that was expressed during the campaign, which was basically anti-Abbott, anti-coalition. Anything we did apparently was wrong, and the people of Australia cast a verdict on that sort of negativity, especially in my home state of Tasmania, where the Green vote was halved. And it might be an idea for the Greens to consider that they have learnt a lesson from this election, and as a result, not be so negative, not be so obstructionist in the Senate. And of course, the same lesson applies to the Australian Labor Party.
Tony Abbott has promised a methodical, low-key government. Having this confrontation in the Senate to kick things off, is that really the image you want to portray as you start your term in government?
The image we'll be portraying is no surprises, and I don't think anybody would be surprised with us seeking to implement the key policy issues, number one, which was abolishing the carbon tax. So if there is confrontation in the Senate, I think the Australian people will know where the confrontation's coming from, and that is the Greens and the ALP not accepting the verdict of the Australian people on Saturday night.
Would the coalition go to a double dissolution or see that as an option before the new Senate came in? It seems more obvious that you would wait to see whether the new senators of July 1, 2014 would be more amenable.
One of the good things about Tony Abbott's leadership has been that we've never got ahead of ourselves, either in opposition or now as a government elect. And we will take it step by step, but we will be encouraging the Senate to accept the verdict of the Australian people in relation to the carbon tax. They don't want it. They see it as a breach of promise. And my own view is that the quicker, especially for the Labor Party, the quicker the Labor Party can cleanse themselves of that breach of promise, the better it will be for the Labor Party. Now, if they want to keep on saying, we lie to the electorate about a carbon tax, and what's more, we are going to continue to defend that lie to the Australian people, despite the verdict of the Australian people, well, the Labor Party will need to accept the consequences that will undoubtedly flow from that belligerent attitude from the Australian people.
Do you think the next Senate will be more amenable, though, as of July 1 next year, from what you've seen?
It's difficult to talk about the makeup of the Senate until we know the exact result, but clearly every indication is that there will be a number of varying views expressed in the Senate, and we will work cooperatively and in a respectful way with every individual senator, and we will seek to persuade them of the appropriateness of our policies, and especially those policies on which we got a mandate, such as border protection, abolition of the carbon tax, abolition of the mining tax, and reduction in company tax.
Given the current Senate, though, is likely to block some of those key measures, including the carbon tax, you'd have to think that the next group, with some more right-leaning micro parties, that'd be a better option for you.
Well, the Labor Party and the Greens have treated the Senate with absolute disrespect. During the last 3 years, where they had a majority, they guillotined 216 bills through the Senate, and in the dying days of the government, knowing what the verdict of the Australian people might be, they guillotined 55 bills through the Senate in one single week. So clearly the Greens and the Labor Party are not the custodians of proper Senate process, and if they continue with that operation, it stands to reason that a change in the makeup of the Senate might actually make it somewhat easier for the government. But having said that, we will take it step by step, day at a time, individual senator by individual senator, ensure that they are considered, that they are respected, and that we get the best possible result for the Australian people.
Now, just on that issue of the double dissolution, before we move on, you accept, given the promise of Tony Abbott to be a methodical, low-key government, that would be anything but low-key, wouldn't it, to go to a double dissolution, to have the turmoil and the uncertainty the business community's already said they don't want to go back to the polls?
Clearly it would be within the nation's interests for us not to have to go back to the polls earlier than the 3 years, but that is predicated on it being overwhelmingly in the national interest that we get rid of this job-destroying, cost-of-living enhancing carbon tax. Unless we get rid of this job-destroying carbon tax, which is mugging the economy, mugging the capacity of people to make their household budgets meet, then clearly something will have to give way. The Australian people have spoken loud and clear in relation to the carbon tax. I don't think anybody can be under any illusion in that regard, and therefore if the low-key nature of the Senate is not as we would want it, that would be as a result of Labor-Green obstinacy and belligerence rather than anything of the government's making.
What's the latest on the prospects of Arthur Sinodinos? Will he survive? Will he remain in the Senate, do you think, on the last count?
There are many, many Australians, and I would imagine not necessarily all coalition supporters, who are hoping that Arthur Sinodinos remains in the Senate. He's a quality package. He's got a lot to offer the Australian nation, and it would be a sad outcome if Arthur Sinodinos were not re-elected to the Senate. And we are hoping that he will, but having said that, it is very, very close, very, very tight, and it's too early to call.
Will you be satisfied to stay in the workplace portfolio? Is that your ambition?
Tony Abbott is aware of my views, and it will ultimately be up to Tony Abbott to give me whatever position he determines appropriate. But anybody that's been following the workplace relations space would know that I'm a bit of a workplace relations tragic, that I do enjoy the portfolio. I did seek it in opposition, and what happens in government will be a matter for Tony.
There was a suggestion that you might be considered for defence. Was there any truth to that?
Look, I don't know where you got that idea from, and at the end of the day, it's up to Tony Abbott to make the determination as to what portfolio he might bestow upon me.
On workplace relations, Tony Abbott has said he won't do anything that would breach your mandate on IR. How far does that mandate extend?
Well, the mandate's very clear. We announced it 4 months before the election in 38 pages of documentation. It was there for everybody to read. The Labor Party went through it, the trade union movement went through it, A lot of commentators went through it, and it's there, no surprises. The package is there. It was out well in advance of the election, one of the earliest workplace relations policies ever put out. And might I remind your viewers that Bill Shorten did not issue a workplace relations policy during this election campaign. So we were the ones with a clear blueprint, with a clear mandate, and we hope that we'll be able to implement it.
Incoming Government Senate Leader, Senator Eric Abetz. Appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you.